in Thief River Falls. It's time once again for the Tuesday Night Experiment, back live where it should be on the airwaves of Pioneer 90.1 FM. Also online, RadioNorthland.org. I'm your host, Glenn Broggett, with you at 7:02 on this Tuesday evening. It's time to once again do our thing. Today we got a big guest at around the 7:30 mark this hour. We have a doctor, our first doctor on the Tuesday Night Experiment.
Oh, boy. Dr. Phil?
No, you silly fool. Dr. Rutledge Taylor, he's going to be our guest. He's going to talk about a documentary film he put together called 3 Billion and Counting. And we'll find out more about 3 Billion and Counting at the bottom of the hour. But first, we got to introduce the Soul Train Dancers. Oh, and then these two dudes that are sitting to my right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the Tuesday Night Experiment players. And let's welcome once again, after the long holiday break, shaking and all together baking, the blind dog, Scotty Gilbert. What's up, my friend?
Yo, what's up?
Well, not too much. How did the holidays treat you, my friend?
Awesome. Stayed away from eggnog.
Well, that's always good. Yeah, I know how you get with that stuff.
Yeah.
Did you?
It was a good time.
All good time. Yeah. What a storm that we had over the New Year's holiday weekend.
I know. Totally crippled, man.
You know, and we had Nora, what's her name? Norma Jean? Russo? Nora Jean?
Nora Jean.
Sorry, Nora.
Yeah,
we had her over the weekend, but unfortunately, the whole thing in Grand Forks didn't work out. I didn't get a chance to check out the thing in Thief River. Did that one go as scheduled?
The Black Cat was awesome.
Oh, cool. Did you go out to it?
Yeah, I was there.
Yeah, well, let's get a first-hand account of it. What was it in a nutshell, my friend?
Awesome the show.
Did you get the blues?
Yeah.
And that's just good stuff indeed, isn't it, my friend?
Oh, you know what, man? It's the atmosphere of it's awesome when you're there live. Yeah.
Feeling
gotta dig it. Yeah. And a Black Cat, man, it's pretty much packed wall to wall.
Oh, that's good. That's really cool considering that the whole thing in Grand Forks just didn't go down because of the weather. It's nice to know that you play to a packed house.
Mother Nature, she can be an evil bitch sometimes, so.
You know, so big ups to the people who attended that to watch Nora and little Bobby and the boys.
Yeah,
it's always a positive thing to get a good crowd because that means there's a chance to get more of this stuff happening in the area.
I tell you what, dude, here in this town, we're like warriors of the weather.
Absolutely.
Just like the mailman that was just on earlier. We go through slow, rain, whatever.
Whatever comes our way, my friend.
So, yeah, it was a good time all in all and a good holiday stretch. Yeah, kind of missed hanging out in the studio here, so.
Well, yeah, when I got a hold of you tonight to remind you to, about the show, you were definitely very enthused about coming on to the program.
Oh, yeah.
And that's awesome to get the enthusiasm level up already on this first live episode of the new year. And I do thank you for stopping by and taking part here for the next couple of hours.
Yeah, who's this sassy character to the left?
I don't know. It looks like he's got a haircut.
Another one.
I don't know. He looked like he's may have did some bodybuilding over the holiday break.
Yeah, geez,
you better look out here.
Lifting straight like bottles of water over there at work or what?
Well, I'm trying to change my habits a little bit.
His habits. Well, let's introduce the man who's changing his habits. Back for 2010, Sugar Sean Slauson.
Well, happy New Year.
We got his music for you for 2011.
Oh, it's party music. You know, it sounds good. Oh. You know, they play this song at work, you know, but I think it's by somebody else. So
this is the Liza Minnelli version for you.
It's kind of make you want to grope a coworker.
depends on who it is, I guess.
I don't care if it's male or female. I'm getting the groove on, man. Hey, I'm doing the soul training experience at work.
What's up, Sugar Man?
It's going all right. How
you
doing?
Pretty good. You got your little flip cam gimmick up and ready to go here.
You know, people
love lift things up and I put them down.
You know, people.
Great spot. Great commercial.
People love what we're doing, you know. And
have you been going around doing some practice for your Man on the Street segment here in the last couple of weeks? Or what's the deal? You say people love what we do.
Well, you know, if you've been following me on YouTube, then yeah.
Okay, well, yeah, but what if the people haven't been following on YouTube? You got to take into account that not everybody knows the genius of Sugar Sean.
They should.
Well, I know, but let's park the ego in the garage for a moment and let's hear what's going on here.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've been doing a few, well, on my YouTube channel. I don't know if you want me to promote it or not.
Well, go ahead. Give us, you can plug it.
YouTube.com/FrankieSlosson.
Who's that?
Yeah, we don't know who that guy is. Anyway.
You got to change
you'll
that.
You'll find my alter ego, you know.
Okay.
My alter ego.
Why can't you just put, like, Frankie Sassy Pants?
Vic
because
Ferrari
can't
or whatever.
Change the username there. YouTube.
They're very strict
really?
About that.
So once you pick a name, you're stuck with it.
Your name for life. It's just like Facebook. Same thing.
Really?
You're stuck for life.
So what's the dealio about this this feedback and this promoting, this you getting ready to be a man on the street in 2011?
Well, you know, all I say is you tell me what you want me to do and it'll be done.
See, I told you what I wanted out of this. I was wanting to know what the feedback's been like because you were talking basically out your butt, it seems like, right now. But, oh, yeah, we got people listening to us everywhere.
That's a good impersonation of me.
No, this is more of your voice.
Am I that nasally or what?
A little bit. Yeah, man. No, I'm just kidding, brother. Now, what's it about? We're getting some good buzz?
No,
is that what you're saying here?
We're doing pretty good. I mean, now that I can do longer videos on YouTube and stuff, it's been helping a lot. You know?
Oh, yeah. What, do they put more, like, space for the videos on there or what?
They must. I mean, they're giving more people
just
on
put it a lower bitrate.
Ancient Sloss and Secret, huh?
I don't know. I mean, it's just pretty exciting what you can do with, technology and stuff. So,
now, how's this going to benefit us?
I don't know.
It's all... See, you're talking some A-game, but you're bringing D results.
Maybe we can get, like, a sponsorship or something. Maybe,
sponsorship. You know. Well, that would be nice. I thought you were going to be our hype man, too, Flava Flav.
I'll be your hype man, your panda bear,
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, boy, Slauson. Well, you know what? I look for big things out of you in 2011.
I do.
Yeah.
Me too.
That means it's the year of Sugar Slauson.
We're going to send you to a city council meeting.
Yep, that's your first assignment.
Yep.
Well, since the mayor and the mailman, they handled the Valley Home thing already. That's scratched off the list.
Yeah.
They've already cornered that market, and, you know, God bless them for it. So we're going to let you go wherever else.
I wonder, we must have had a tough time getting that place in between bingo sessions,
yeah.
You know?
You know, it is hard to get their attention if bingo hour's going on.
Tell you, man, you pissed off a gray-haired with a bingo dauber. Man, you're getting chased all the way down the hallway to the nurse's station.
Sure enough, 100%.
I know that by experience.
100% natural fact. You used to date out there, right?
Not what?
what the heck are you doing
yeah,
over Valley Home?
This hot-looking nurse, man.
Jeez.
She's a little kinky, man.
She stays there, too. She's got a roommate. It's kind of a bother, man.
Yeah. Well, she was kind of deaf, so I didn't care.
So are you saying we can't do a live remote from
You know
home?
What? Sky's the limit. We can, you know, let's look into the weeks and months ahead of the show.
I
want
to send you up to the city council.
Yep. Represent.
And ask questions that do not pertain to the city.
Yeah.
When is Thief River going to get a strip club? You know, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I know Beaver there. He would love to hear about that.
Oh. Yeah, there we go. We need to call it Beavers.
He could be the owner.
Yeah.
Take over.
Yeah. Dream. He could be a bouncer.
Keeping that bar raised oh so high, you guys,
yeah.
All the time.
We just want management over here real quick, of course.
Okay, Sugar Sean, we got a lot of things to do here in 2011.
Yes,
so
we do.
And we're going to be, in the next couple of weeks, we'll talk about getting you some assignments.
Heck yeah.
You know, Blind Dog and I are your executive producers.
You know,
after
thinking about this over the holiday weekend, I'm actually getting more excited now than I was when I was first announced.
Before you went nuts at Christmas?
Yeah. I mean, did you drink a lot of eggnog?
Eggnog is mucus. We don't drink mucus.
Really? What do you guys drink at the house? You bust out the schnapps or what?
Well, my brother bought a Coors Light keg. You know?
Yeah,
but
what,
I didn't
the,
have
the
it.
Small little one you can fit in the fridge?
Yeah.
Come on, you guys are pussies,
did
man.
Did you have any sips?
No, I smelt it a little bit, so maybe does that count?
That's right, you don't drink beer.
He refrains from the spirits.
Do you drink whiskey?
Drink water.
Just water, all you'd like
real
vodka.
Real men drink water.
Real men drink vodka. Come on now.
Well, guys, it's nice to know that we've had some great holiday
Where
time.
Where are you
going?
We got a class that just got out here at the college.
Studios this way. Come on, baby. Don't run away. Don't run away. Just don't because I'm
the,
blind.
We're going to have to close the blinds here, guys.
Yeah, no kidding.
Just because I'm blind, baby. Once you go blind, you never go back.
All right, guys, we've
okay,
I think we've covered up what we've done over the holidays, and well, let's get into some comments, some topics, and one of the big things that kind of sprouted up here while we were away doing our thing here at the Tuesday Night Experiment was the rise of the Golden Homeless Voice, or Golden Voice Homeless
yeah.
DJ. Where did we find this guy? Ted Williams.
gotta love Ted, you know.
And I think I got a little clip here that talks a little bit about Ted's story. I'm gonna kill this Love Unlimited Orchestra spiel.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
I want a copy of that.
Last week, he amazed America as the man with the golden voice. But will folks remember Ted Williams' name next week? Experts tell Fox 411 they're concerned Williams is a, quote, pawn in the media game until the next hot thing comes along. He's been compared to Susan Boyle, whose rise to fame was followed by a hospital stay for exhaustion. But unlike Boyle, he's not a reality TV star.
He looks like an Obama in the 1970s.
He's a recovering addict who's living on the streets and lacks a publicity machine to advise and protect him. Homeless advocates also tell Fox 411 they hope his 15 minutes lasts, but they're concerned he may not be equipped to cope with his sudden fame. You may have read...
There it is, gang.
I was waiting for a news actuality on there. Come on.
Okay,
where's
hold on.
The clip? No, not that one. That one. No, we're saving that one for the end.
I don't think we got a news actuality. I think we just got the clip here. Here's the clip that we pulled from this is actual.
I was gonna say there's already a crackhead doing voiceover out there.
Okay, Mr. Busey, the lawyer says you've already been paid, so all we need is the line Pop Tarts. Okay,
let's roll one. Whoa!
All right.
Whoa! All right. Yeah, let's do this thing. Semper Fi. What is the line again, please?
Pop Tarts.
You lie, and your feet stink. That's a terrible line.
That's the copy the client prefers, Mr. Busey.
There we go. Gary Busey is doing Pop-Tart spots. Oh, but we got some news about Mr. Ted Williams, Mr. Golden Voice DJ. Well, should we do it in our Golden Voice DJ, our own Golden Voices?
Hey, why not?
Well, Ted Williams, the Ohio homeless man whose golden voice made him a YouTube sensation and brought him offers of work, was detained by the Los Angeles Police Department Monday night at a Hollywood hotel. According to law enforcement sources, Williams and an unidentified family member were detained after police were called to the Renaissance Hotel on a disturbance charge.
That's his sister.
Okay.
Yep.
That was found here?
Yep. Yeah, that's his sister he got in a little domestic with, fighting over the crack pipe.
Williams was eventually released, and the sources said the investigation was continuing. Sources stressed it's unclear if any arrests would result from the probe. I'm getting tired of that voice. Sources spoke of the condition of anonymity because the case was ongoing. He was in Los Angeles for several television appearances, including Entertainment Tonight. Earlier Monday, he even visited the Lakers. Oh, I love you, Kobe Bryant. I get to meet you. What's the deal with this? You know what?
That sounds more like Forrest Gump.
Yeah.
But didn't he kind of sound like him when he was I'm getting tired of the whole Ted Williams thing. Yeah, it was great. Like last week, slow news week. You know, hey, great feel good story. Yeah. You know, congratulations. You're doing well. Good job. You finally, you're picking yourself up by your boot heels. But the thing is, you know. And you know this, too, being in the radio business.
Yeah.
There's plenty of radio people with great voices that are on the unemployment line.
They're
probably homeless. There's people who are working in the radio business that are homeless.
There's probably people in the business that live in the radio station.
Exactly.
Come on, man.
So, I mean, this guy, I think he kind of just took the backdoor route to get himself some fame and a job. But this whole YouTube thing, he got instant celebrity. I just think, what about these other ones with great voices and great talents?
Well, they said,
what about Gilbert Gottfried?
Come on now. Well, they said the guy who put the video together put it on the YouTube, or actually on the District of Columbia page or whatever, because it was a slow news week.
Yeah, he was a guy from the paper there.
Yeah, originally he was just going to, throw the footage away, obviously, but I guess Ted Williams is lucky.
You know, and that's why he put the footage on there, is because it was a slow news week there.
Yeah,
so that's how Ted Williams got so famous.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of weird how that...
When you're listening to Golden Oldies.
But it's like how many homeless
Tune
people...
Tune in tomorrow morning for a chance to win tickets to see this guy.
Yeah,
but how many homeless people would you give a job to if they had a radio voice? Are there other people out there in the world that...
I was saying, man, there's plenty of other talent out there. I mean, there's a couple of us sitting in the room.
Yeah.
We would like a full-time gig.
Heck, I would,
Do we have to go out, find a little area, underneath the railroad track...
Yeah.
...and get yourself all rolling around in some dirt, whatever it takes to get yourself to create the effect? We'll videotape you. We'll get you little... Sugar Sean's little flip cam gimmick over here.
Flip cam.
Flip cam it up here, and we'll have, hey, here's a dollar. Do some radio. Do some liners or some sound bites for us.
Let's do it. Put it together, man.
Yeah,
That's your first street gig.
Yep.
Heck, you know, it'd be fun to make a parody of that. That would be hilarious. but I need you guys' help, though.
Oh, you already.
You guys can, you know, we need actors. You know,
Blind Eye, do you think you could be our main guy? We'll have you out there. Well, because I mean, you got the voice. You got the golden voice, my friend.
I got the golden voice.
Yeah, we can have a gate. So yeah. Let's practice this here. He's got the camera over. Put the camera on him, and we'll do something here. We'll do some camera work on the radio.
Should I do it by Ted Williams' voice?
Okay, yeah. And 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, action.
What's the light again?
Let's just do something about golden oldies. You're listening to
the other state. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, let's try this again. Take two. The other stations. No, I gotta go deeper.
There, you need a barf bucket.
The other stations play crap, but we play the oldies.
All right, could we do one for a chance to win concert tickets? And 3, 2, 1, make this money. Action.
Caller number 9. Number 9. 1-888-88. 888.
That's too many eights.
Come on, are you paying attention there in that room? Okay, next contest.
All right, so we're going to hit this. We'll go. What, do you got one?
Lost a loved one in the family. Feel it's time to drink.
We'll come on over to the Bottle Bar Liquor Store where we got a closeout sale on all 2010 wines.
Everything must go. It's the dime sale.
at the Bottle Bar.
We can do it, man.
Where's our Ted Williams moment in the sun?
Yeah, no kidding.
Thank you for calling AT&T.
Oh, but you see,
your call is very important
to us. You're missing something. See, something that's most important.
Well, we don't get some je ne sais quoi.
You're missing the afro. You know, you gotta have that. That was the moneymaker.
Should I put my stocking hat on, man?
That was the moneymaker.
Well, we can have this. We can do a theater of the mind thing.
Sure. Okay, that's I got the afro on. Can't you hear it touching the microphone?
Wait, hold on. Should we put some music on that may have a little more funk to it?
Sure.
Okay, let's get on Sergio Mendez for a moment.
Oh, there you go.
Well, that's only 17 seconds.
You've seen Shaft.
Is this Shaft?
Well, this is like something a Shaft-like thing. That was just a 17-second clip here.
Yeah.
Should we go? Okay, I got mid-60s brassy DJ bit, so I want some energy. I want some full-on enthusiasm. Here we go.
In the world, at the disco party, the drunk guy shows up.
Hey, what's going on, man? How you doing, buddy?
It's my friend Tequila.
Hey, how you doing?
Come on, man. Drink, drink.
Coming to theaters this week, Tequila on the Beach, starring
this guy.
This guy right here. Special appearances by Morgan Freeman.
No people under 17 admitted without a parent.
Oh, man.
I love that. That
is funny.
Eric Estrada stars in the feel-good action.
Start that one over, man. That sounds like a news bed.
Okay.
All right, here we go.
Right. We're going to get Blind Dog a big-time radio voice work job with this one.
Here we go.
When breaking news breaks, break in. We're on the scene first with breaking news. Now to our news chopper. Here's Chopper Eddie.
Well, I don't see much traffic going on over there. There's some going down. I can look over by a back road here, right below me. Looks like a couple of cars have stopped. They might be having a brief little party out here in this back road. Back to you, Irv.
And for up-to-date weather forecast information, let's head over to Weather Central with Steven Stevenson.
Hi, this is Steven Stevenson with the weather forecast today. Looks like the sun's going to be out, then it's going to get dark, and then it's going to get bright again.
And for the drive home during your work week, tune into the 5 o'clock cruise.
Hey, everybody, it's the 5 o'clock cruise, a cruise you just can't lose. We got some comedy bits and all your favorite hits.
And spend your nights with Silly Sally.
Hello, darling. This is Silly Sally. I have a deep cigarette-throated voice.
Breaking news, 24/7, 1490 a.m.
Your home of classic hits.
Yeah.
We got 19 seconds. We got to kill this, buddy.
We break news before news even breaks.
Don't forget.
Yeah, what was that?
I think that one's a dandy. Let's roll tape on that. I think we got it safe.
The YouTube audience will like this, I tell you. Oh, boy.
Well, you know, we're just trying to create this theater of the mind thing. Yeah. You know, we've been inspired by
this. It's like you, the listener, are in the voiceover booth right now.
Exactly. I mean, we are capturing vintage radio right there. Sugar Sean, you know the game.
Oh, heck yeah, I do.
Well, where were you on that? You were just holding the camera.
I was just
the
camera.
New character voices.
I was just the camera guy. That was
step right on up.
I was the you know, and I don't mean to be racist, but I was the Japanese camera guy. So hey.
Well, let's hear some Sugar Sean. Do a little voice work for us here.
Well, when okay, hold on here. I got to
come on, Dad. There's all distractions right. All the time in the studio.
Oh, all yeah. Right, here we go. Ready and action.
What you really. Really have had enough to eat. Is it not time to use the toilet?
Oh my god.
I don't know, that was horrible, I know.
Frankie slosson, toilet bowl cleaner. When pooping isn't just enough.
Now in cinnamon spice.
Oh man.
See, that's the way you got to do it. This is the theater of the mind,
yes,
there, Sugar
yes,
Sean.
I know.
All right,
I
you got a, you got a minute 28. One more time to redeem yourself.
Have you ever had a bowl of soup that looks like puke?
Wow, we really need that. That ain't add the best subtract lib.
And how many people are in a drive-thru now?
I don't know.
You got to remember, these people have some people have weak stomachs.
Yeah, no, radio are in cars now these
days.
Yeah,
yeah, they are, aren't they? Oh, boy.
This is Ted Williams telling Sugar Sean to, you better get back to Ad-Lib College, buddy.
Better just stick with the YouTubing, probably.
Oh, man, that was a great bit.
Yeah.
I do say so. Well, I got 47 seconds. There's one more chance for him to pull out some magic.
Pull out some magic. Yeah, I'll just get my hat, you know, I'll get the bunny rabbit going here.
Okay, 36 seconds. You're wasting.
Oh, man, you're wasting Memorex here. Come on.
This is your tryout here. This you could be the next Ted Williams.
Well, Ted Williams.
Come on.
But Ted Williams, you know, is a Hollywood legend.
We're going to call him Stalin Sean Slauson.
You would have a great voice for, like, a Toys R Us commercial, man. You know
when
what I mean?
A kid can be a kid.
Yeah, there
yeah,
we go.
There we go.
A kid can be a kid.
Next
or,
time.
Frankie's Bottle Shop.
Yeah, when you're out of liquor, come to Frankie's Bottle Shop. We'll liquor you up.
There we
that's
go.
That's right. Hey,
hit that pose, too. Well, there we go, gang. That's our attempted big potential Ted Williams type radio stars here on the radio station. This is the Tuesday Night Experiment. And, you know, the one thing I remember about big old Ted was when he got reunited with his mom.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's a great moment to be reunited with your mom. But
she's 90 years old.
But the whole thing with him, he's a 50-some-year-old man yelling, Mommy, Mommy. Oh, I finally made it, Mommy. I'm not going to blow it this time. The prodigal son has returned.
Prodigal son. That was a Kid Rock song. I'd rather listen to Kid Rock.
You're a devil without a
prodigal
cause.
Prodigal son, man. No, that's Seven Bucks. It does.
I don't know. That was Kid Rock.
Thinking about.
Kid what? Rock. It was like a devil too, but
oh,
Kid
no,
Rock,
there's two different titles. Come on now.
Oh, well. I guess I don't know
Kid
anything
Rock.
About music, I guess.
You should have left him behind in 2010.
I'm sorry, I can't.
25 minutes after 7 o'clock, can't help but talk like him right now.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
WNBC.
Let's go downtown and check in on the electronics store.
Well, hopefully we'll have our guest here at the bottom of the hour, Dr. Rutledge Taylor, to talk about $3 billion and counting. We'll get an education lesson to kind of deflect from our
I think we need education.
Our radio vomit-a-thon here that just went down. I still think it was quite good.
Howard Rocky, if you're listening, I'm sorry. I never really meant to be a puker.
And we love you dearly if you're listening.
Absolutely. We love you, Howard.
He's the radio jihadist right there, man.
He's the man. Yeah. We'll be right back with some more great music from Eagles of Death Metal in the Tuesday Night Experiment.
Woo! Programming is supported by Ampers, offering an opportunity to discover what's new on the Minnesota art scene at ampers.org. Empress.org has more than 1,200 music, arts, and cultural stories, including many produced by this radio station. Information and audio at Empress.org. Empress Diverse Radio for Minnesota's communities.
And so I got into some teen bands in high school and in college, and then along came the day job, and now my muse is calling me again.
This week on Minnesota Arts on the Road, our guest is Thief River Falls singer, songwriter, and guitarist Carl Unbehound.
If you see me on the sly, just remember I'm the guy you conveniently ripped from your life.
Listen Wednesday at 1 on Pioneer 90.1 and online at RadioNorthland.org.
Instead of friend and lover and wife.
The Tuesday Night Experiment on Pioneer 90.1 FM, RadioNorthland.org. And gang, it's interview time here on the Tuesday Night Experiment. And our guest on the telephone is with us to discuss his documentary film, 3 Billion and Counting. A film that gives valuable information on the band chemical DDT and what we may or may not know about this chemical and how this chemical in the present day could possibly aid in battling many diseases like malaria and even the West Nile virus and some of the things with bed bugs, too. And with us on the phone to tell us about it, because I can't explain this as good as this man can, is Dr. Rutledge. Now, good evening to you, Dr. Rutledge.
Well, good evening to you and everyone out in Minnesota. You're listening to a Mississippi voice all the way from Los Angeles.
Mississippi in L.A. How you doing tonight, sir? And let's before we get into 3 Billion and Counting, let's get some information about yourself here, a little bit of your backstory.
Okay, well, I grew up on a farm in Mississippi. That's some of my interest of chemicals and background like that. And then I was going to be a budding marine biologist, but things didn't go that way. Ended up going to medical school and got board certified in family practice. I always have had an interest in chemicals and things. And I started a medical practice doing preventive medicine, nutrition, anti-aging, stuff like that. So I use prescription medicines and detox and nutritional supplements, blending Eastern and Western medicine. And, you know, that's what I do.
Mm-hmm. And let's get into this this film that you've made, this documentary, 3 Billion and Counting. And what made you decide to take on such a project, this 3 Billion and Counting?
Well, you know, it's kind of like going to medical school. If you speak with many doctors, if they knew what they were getting into, they might not have done it. It's overwhelming. I had no idea really what I was getting into, but once I got into it, I could not stop. I just found out more and more facts, more and more shenanigans that were happening. It started out, it was in 2004, I had a lot of patients asking me how to prevent West Nile virus, and I didn't know a lot about it at the time, so I said, well, let me check into it, let me see. So, you know, I started doing research on the internet on vector-borne, which is insect-borne type diseases, and malaria just keeps popping up constantly. Well, I ran across an article in Nature that said that over 500 million people every year were getting infected with malaria. Wow. And it just blew my mind. I could not believe it. And sure enough, that was the case. I thought it was an old world disease. You know, mm-hmm. We studied malaria and microbiology in college and in medical school, and you just think, oh, well, you know, that's something that is almost gone. Well, I did not know that it was that many people being infected. So once I did that, you start doing a little more research on malaria, and then you cannot Google malaria without the word DDT coming up. Mm-hmm. And I grew up on a farm, and I thought my dad, you know, my dad used it, and they all said, oh, there's nothing wrong with this stuff. But, you know, I was very skeptical because, you know, most pesticides and things have a pretty serious deleterious effect to human biophysiology. And so, you know, I was digging deeper, and I called a friend of mine who was Linus Pauling's partner. And it was the guy that did all the vitamin C studies in cancer. This guy was a heavyweight. I said, well, let me ask him about it. So I flew up to San Francisco, and I met with him to ask him about this. I said, you know, it seems like this DDT is not as bad as it's been made out to be, but I just don't know. And he said, I can tell you this I know. that it's a technologic genocide that's happening right now by the withdrawal of technology. These people are very smart, and they know what they're doing. And when he said that to me, my life had changed. It was, at that moment, changed. Mm-hmm. I could not stop thinking about it. And so I talked with a friend of mine here in Los Angeles. I said, look, let's just hire a cameraman. We bought a couple of cameras, and we just took off to Africa. And that led us to India, which led us to Indonesia and Malaysia, and then eventually to South America, and then all the way back onto the doorstep of Washington, D.C., where really everything went down.
Mm-hmm. No, we talked about, you mentioned DDT, and of course it was in, what, the early 1970s that led to an environmental ban on it. Now, what do you think led the DDT to getting such a bad reputation, and why do you think they shut it down as far as banning this chemical?
Well, you know, there's a lot of theories out there about that. What I have found through my digging is that it was the first stamp of authority for the newly formed Environmental Protection Agency. They were formed in 1970. William Ruckelshaus was the first head of the Environmental Protection Agency at the time. This was a power move. There's two prongs to it. The whole environmental movement starting in the 1960s, mainly with nuclear testing, that's what their claim to fame was about that. But then, you know, pesticides are scary to people because you don't understand them. Things you can't see, you know, it's kind of like physics, or, you know, things that you don't really understand well, you can be fearful of. Well, Rachel Carson, I dug up a ton of facts and read her book, Silent Spring, and all those things. The environmental movement started, and people were concerned about overuse of pesticides. Mm-hmm. And were some of them overused? Yes, they were. Was DDT overused? Probably. Did it do all the harm of things that they say that it did? Not at all. I have all the facts to back it up. 5 filing cabinets of all the studies on DDT dating back to the 1940s. You know, to answer your question, the reason it got banned was an ideology that it was being overused and was going to harm the earth. It was something called the precautionary principle. Mm-hmm. But you can't operate. You can't. I mean, if you went by the precautionary principle, you'd never cross the road because you might get hit by a car. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So the environmental protection, it was a power move for them to establish power over the chemical industry. And then they systematically started banning other pesticides and things. And some of them should have been banned, some not. And that has resulted in us not having anything that will really treat bed bugs in this country.
And you really hear a lot about, like in this past year, a lot of reports and the whole big rise of the bed bug thing. It's starting to become a rampant thing all over the country. It's not just in isolated areas. It seems like there was more cases coming up in different parts of the country.
I just read yesterday where there's a lot of cases popping up in Louisiana.
You know,
it's really a disgrace in a sense that all of America is being infested with bed bugs. And an interesting tidbit, I won't mention any names, but this is a very professional guy that knows a lot about bed bugs and DDT in Kentucky. And I inquired, because I mentioned this when I was on another radio program, that there has not been one study done with DDT in bed bugs in 30 years. So when they say that bed bugs are resistant to DDT, they don't know that. They're postulating that. Now, because of cross-resistance with something called pyrethrins. And yes, pyrethrins are what they put on bed nets. And so you can have cross-resistance. However, there was a study that I believe this guy did in Kentucky. And when I inquired about it, and that's what you have to do, you have to really look deeply in all these studies and things, they used 5% DDT. That's minuscule. I drank 75% DDT in the film, through mm-hmm. Bannon County, 3,000 milligrams of it. It took a major load just really to prove how safe it is. There's not been one single human death or animal death attributed to DDT? None. In 70 years of its use.
And it just amazes me how they're not looking into bringing it back in some way, shape, or form. It just seems like they're sticking behind what they've, this outmoded way of thinking. And this is many lives have been, you know, have people have perished, and there's lots of lives in the balance when it comes to with the way they've dealt with the malaria thing too.
Oh, I know. That's right. But you know, a lot of, especially governments, they don't want to admit ever that they were wrong. They want to spin it in some kind of way. And I'm going to tell you this. This is the largest scam that the U.S. government has ever perpetrated on the world. It's resulted in more death than any of the wars. In fact, all the wars combined cannot measure up to all the deaths that have been attributed to the ban of DDT, and it is the safest pesticide on the planet.
It is just amazing, you know, since the ban in 72, just the fallout from it. And, you know, and it's not just a malaria thing. You got the West Nile virus that has sprung up, too, as well as the bed bug thing. It's just, it's got to come to a point. The buck's got to stop here on this. There's got to be more research into this stuff. It's just time has come.
It has. And, you know, I don't know if you've ever heard of dengue fever. Mm-hmm. But that is transmitted by mosquitoes, too, and there's been about 1,500 or so cases in Florida of that. And let me tell you about dengue fever. And if you contract malaria, you feel like you're going to die. They say if you contract dengue, you wish you would die, because a nickname for it is bone-crushing fever. My point is, there's more and more of these vector or insect-borne diseases that are cropping up all over the country, and they have taken away many of our tools to fight these things. And pests, I mean, they are an enemy. You will never, ever kill all the mosquitoes or kill all the bed. You know, you can't, but you can keep things at bay. And that's one of the things that's been lost in this country.
Mm-hmm. Now, how much did you meet much resistance while making this film from, like the EPA and Greenpeace and the World Wildlife Fund and the Sierra Club? Because, I mean, do you think these have vested interest in this stuff as well?
Well, yeah, well, they see, what they do is they're against things. They never recommend a solution. So Greenpeace, Sierra, World Wildlife, all the environmental groups, whether they're well-intentioned or not, they go against something, and they spend billions, actually, of dollars to go against something, but they never, ever recommend a solution. Why is that? Because they don't have one. You know, they just want to have control and power. The people in the tops of the environmental groups, they know what they're doing. There's many people out there, and I have many friends that contribute to certain environmental groups because they're well-intended, mm-hmm. but they're not well-informed.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you honestly think DDT will ever get legalized in any shape or form in our lifetimes?
Well, you know, here's the technical of it. It's banned in this country. Mm-hmm. It's not banned elsewhere. However, what America says to Africa and Indonesia and certain countries that want to use it, okay, it's fine if you use DDT to save your people, but if you do, we're going to cut off all your funding. So, you know, what do corrupt governments do? They're not going to do that. They're not going to use it and risk having all their funding cut off from the United States. So it's blackmail, you know, in a sense. And, you know, to answer your question, I don't know. I think if through awareness, through your listeners talking about this, and telling other people about it, many people say, you know, once they've seen my film, well, what can I do about it? Mm-hmm. What can we do? And, the only answer that I have is awareness. Get the facts, talk about it, spread the word. DDT is safe, and we should be able to use it. It's just like medicine, anything. You have to be careful and use things properly. But I can tell you this, DDT, you can take a bath in it, you can get it all in your eyes, you can get it, you can drink it. It is non-harmful. It's not harmful to humans. I've gone through every argument, and I go through it systematically in the documentary and find facts. I found the 9,000-page document that was buried in the National Archives where stellar doctors and scientists from all over the world at that time said, do not ban DDT. And what did they do? They banned it anyway. They banned it knowing that it would affect millions upon millions of actually black, brown, and yellow babies all over the world. I mean, white people do not die from malaria. I mean, there's a few, but the majority of people of color.
You know, we definitely would love to kind of help spread the word here about DDT and about this film. We're with Dr. Rutledge talking about his great documentary, $3 Billion and Counting. And we would definitely, if we can get the chance to maybe possibly have a screener of this movie, we could probably get something scheduled up in this area to let people know about this and to create some sort of awareness, whether it's at the college or in the surrounding communities. I think we can definitely find a place and a venue to get this movie shown because it tackles very important subject matter.
Well, I'm definitely open to that, and let's talk further on that. I can definitely get you a screener. I would love to screen it for people all in the area. Like I said, it's awareness. Awareness is so powerful. When the whole populace becomes aware of something, then governments or anyone else can never have anything over on you. They can't scam you. They can't tell you because you know the truth.
Exactly. Truth will set us free in this case.
That's right.
And what's the reaction? What has it been like now in this country since you've released the movie and had some screeners? What has that been like for you as far as
we released it in New York in Los Angeles, and it hasn't gone available in DVD yet because there's some African governments and things that are looking at screening it, and so right now it's been kind of quiet. Mm-hmm. However, everyone that sees it just says, I cannot get this film out of my mind. Mm-hmm. And the reason that is that it opens up so many things for them of how if they were scammed this way, what else have they been lied to about? Mm-hmm. And so, what it taught me and it should teach anyone is to look deep for the truth. You don't have to know everything, but and I wanted to ask you, Glenn, when you knew of DDT, did you think it was bad or good or not?
Well, I was under the impression that it was a bad thing. It was harmful for that whole thing with the Silent Spring. Hearing about that and then hearing from older people growing up, they mentioned it, but they said, well, they don't use that anymore because that's bad for you. That's bad for the environment. I had nothing but a negative sort of viewpoint on it up until recently when I had my ears opened up to this movie and to the possibilities of DDT being a positive thing. And that was very, very much an eye and ear opening sort of event for me. And now that I've had this awakening, I really want to share the knowledge with others. That's how I really feel about it.
When I interviewed the head of the only last remaining chemical plant in the world, it's in India, he said to me, how do you kill a dog? You give it a bad name. And that's what happened to DDT. They sold it as a bad, bad chemical. And, in my opinion, it's because it was working too well. It was saving too many lives. And there was an ideology back in the 60s that the Earth is overpopulated. Well, if you look at the true science, the Earth is not overpopulated. All you have to do is get on an airplane and fly over the Midwest and look down. You hardly ever see any houses. The only people that think the Earth is overpopulated are people who live in cities. At that time, there was an ideology of that. Well, science has disproven that. In fact, in the United States, you have to have 2.1 children per couple to sustain our population presently. And that's not happening. We wouldn't be sustaining our population if it wasn't for immigration.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to have to mention this, and this is how I come across you in your movie. I was listening to, of all places, the Howard Stern Show, and you were on there talking about it. It was, I think, one of the people on the show informed Howard about this, but I thought that the interview that you did with him via phone was one of the things that also helped me become in touch with all of this, and I thought that you did a wonderful job on that show.
Well, I thank you for that. Howard's fun. You got to be prepared to go just about anywhere with Howard.
Oh, yeah, he wasn't letting you, giving you any sort of mercy, but he was definitely engaged in what you were saying, and he was very much interested in it, especially with the bed bug aspect of it. And, of course, him being in living in the New York area, that's one of those areas that were harder hit by that whole thing.
Well, you know, I will say this. Howard is very controversial. However, he does have a knack. It's kind of like a pit bull. He will go at the truth of something. I do know that about him, and that's what I was impressed about, that he knew something was rotten in Denmark on this whole DDT story.
Mm-hmm. And I read here that you enlisted some celebrity help to make the music for the thing. We're talking about Debbie Gibson. I saw that there.
You know, actually, she scored the film,
mm-hmm.
and the end title credit song is entitled Rise, and you know, possibly we could get you a copy of that and get a listen to that.
Oh, sure.
It's right now, it's on the short list for the Academy Awards for Best Original Song.
Oh, excellent, excellent. It's nice to nice little accolade there, potentially.
Yeah, you know, you're kind of like the little song that could.
Right on.
It's kind of like a We Are the World song, if you will, but much more depthful and powerful.
Oh, very cool. Well, I definitely owe Debbie a little bit. You know, she was it was one of her songs that I had my very first slow dance to in junior high school. I just wanted to say that. I have to thank her for
that. I hear that a lot.
Well, I think it was Lost in Your Eyes, and I'll never forget that moment. Is there any last words before we send you out here on your way about $3 billion and counting?
No, I want to thank you for having me on your show. I really do appreciate it. My goal is to get this word out. If more and more people will become aware of this subject matter, it will just stop the deaths. A woman or a child is dying every 12 seconds to malaria, and it's completely, completely preventable. If millions know about this subject, billions will be saved.
All right. Want to tell a little bit about the website, too, before we head out?
Yeah, $3billionandcounting.com. Please go there, check it out, read, find out everything you can. The best thing that people can do, like I said, is just send the link around on the internet, talk about it, talk to your friends about it, become educated on the subject matter, and like I said, you know, through awareness, we make the change.
I want to thank you for taking time out of your schedule. We'll definitely communicate through email about getting a possible screener up in these parts.
That sounds great.
All right. Thanks so much, Dr. Rutledge, for taking some time to talk about $3 billion in counting. You have yourself a fantastic evening. Take care of yourself, and we'll talk somewhere on down the line.
You too, Glenn. I appreciate it.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. That's Dr. Rutledge. We learned a little bit about DDT, a little chemical here. That was a very, very good interview, I have to say.
Yeah.
You know, usually we were joking around, like you said, the first half of the show, we had some good times and good yucks about our favorite DJ, but then we actually sit and we actually learned something, too.
I thought you were talking about Diamond Dallas Page.
DDP or
something. Yeah, I was lost in the dirt there, man. I thought we were going to talk wrestling, man, not no chemical.
Oh, come on.
Okay, no, that's cool.
But boy, bed bugs, though, that's been just something that's been talked about a lot in the last year and a half. I mean, and that's something that's been traveling all over the country, too.
Oh, for sure. It started on the East West Coast, and it's making way inward.
Yeah, and you know what? If DDT is something that will help us out, well, by God, let's at least do some research, some thorough research. Stop being stubborn and just give it a shot.
Yeah, you can't kill bed bugs, can you?
I'd go out in the street and say, hey, will you give me a DDT?
Oh, boy. Boo earns.
Get back to cutting commercials.
Well, we're going to have to work with Sugar Sean on that. But, Dr. Rutledge, we're definitely going to try to like get something as far as a screener for that movie, probably at the college and stuff.
Yeah,
we got a theater here, man.
I think that would be really a good thing. And it's not some joke. It's actually a legitimate thing and a legitimate issue. I think, you know, I don't want to get preachy about it, but I think it's something that would actually be of some interest and of some use to people. For people.
Sure. You know, I'm pretty sure they used it around here back in that day.
Well, absolutely. And it's like you said, it sounds like it was more of a political thing than it was anything else.
Is that why you got six toes?
That might have been. And the thing is, the thing that really sold me on the story was that he actually drank a good amount of DDT.
How did he score that?
I think they'll tell you more about that in the movie.
Oh, right.
Yeah, we
right.
got to have some teasers and pleasers.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. You want
to... We don't want to give it all away. Hey, we're going to go to the top of the hour with some Bad Religion, a track from their latest album, Descent of Man, called It's Not DDT. Welcome back to the Tuesday Night Experiment.
I feel like we're at a club right now.
Oh, yes. We're at Shea Sean.
We're at the old club lounge with Ralph Bennett.
Oh, yeah. I heard from Ralphie Boy. He's one of my friends on the Facebook. Is he yours too?
I think so, yes.
Yeah, Ralph's a good guy. Ralph
Swenson.
Yeah, Ralph Swenson. Very good guy. We'll give our shout outs to Ralphie Boy tonight. This is Tuesday Night Experiment on Pioneer 90.1, RadioNorthland.org. I'm Glenn Broggett, along with the Blonde Dog, Scotty Gilbert.
I'm a Ted Williams wannabe.
As we talked about and dissected in hour number one to full effect. We all have this, and Sugar Sean, Sassy Pants, Sassafras.
Yeah.
Or just plain
Sassy.
Or just plain Slosson with the Bruce Willis haircut.
Is that what your woman calls you?
He's got a Bruce Willis haircut. Your life should be like start like a Bruce Willis movie where you're always hung over and you have to save the world. Wasn't there like 9 of his movies that where he's hung over and he's like some sort of a fallen from grace figure?
Yes.
He's always like the cop who's like, you're on thin ice there, Mahoney, or whatever your name is.
Mahoney? You're thinking Police Academy.
No, it could be. I'm just saying a random name.
Yeah, that'd be a good
listen, place. Markowitz. This is the way it's going to sit. He's always he was like that in the Die Hards. He was like that in that Striking Distance movie.
Yes.
He was like that movie with Alec Baldwin and the autistic kid.
In the end, he's the hero. You know?
Well, of course.
He's Bruce. He's Bruno. You know?
I don't know about that Bruno business.
Bruno. Come on.
Did you know I actually buy a Bruce Willis CD? You know, because
the Return of Bruno you bought?
Well, no. This is like a Universal.
He put
Masters.
An audio CD out?
Yeah.
Really?
Like 18 yeah, he, tracks.
He, it's right up there with the Bacon Brothers.
Yeah. He had that album in the 80s when he was doing his blues alter ego, Bruno.
Oh, yeah.
Like on
the
boardwalk and all that.
Yeah, he did Youngblood and Jackpot and all those songs.
Bruno's Bop.
You know, I should like look for that online. Bruce Willis singing.
Yeah, and his big hit to...
Respect yourself.
Yeah, respect yourself.
But I got on YouTube. I want to hear that. Come
I got,
on
I
now.
Got the CD and I got it from Amazon. I was really
Is it
happy.
Autographed?
No, sadly no. But
here you go, know, kid. Here's my autograph.
Autographed my heart. You know?
Oh.
And then I got cancer. Anyway,
flag on the play there, Sugar Sean. Flag on the play.
Flag on the play.
Bruce Willis, respect yourself. I'm trying to queue it up here on the old computer, but it's not giving me any go here.
Uh-oh. Oh, we have technical problems.
I think
again?
I offended it.
I think Ted Williams has a curse on here. So.
Well, sorry, Sugar Sean. I didn't mean to offend you like that.
I really like Mama.
We'll win tickets to see you anyway.
Well, you know what, man?
YouTube will have it, man. Throw it on.
Yeah. YouTube will definitely have it.
Okay, well, I'm going to get on there.
Not XTube, dude. You can't be hitting that crap.
Or not YouTube or RedTube or whatever.
Well, RedTube? What's that all
I
about?
I can't tell you.
I'm trying to get this thing hooked up here, and you guys are giving me nothing but grief.
Is that a website that shows the color red?
Just use your imagination, you know?
Okay.
Won't. I don't
red
go into
tube.
I won't go into further, but, you know. Yeah.
Test tube.
Test tube, yes.
Is that where he came from?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Jeez.
There we go.
Okay. So you can only trust the National
Enquirer. Oh, man. It's a live version. Let me cue this gimmick up. He's trying to be funny. Oh, he's introducing stuff. Let's find like a real video for this, man. I don't want to.
There's my band.
There's a song that he did called Devil
Woman.
Some
guy just waved at us.
Yeah, that's Howard. Howard Stowe, the janitor. Yeah, I know him. He used to work at Panda. Hugo's. Yeah.
Oh, overnight God. There we go, again. Another shameless plug.
Yeah, it's a local plug.
Here we go. This is Bruce Willis' version, Under the Boardwalk.
Track number one on the CD I have.
Thanks, Cliff Clavin.
I didn't even know the track listings.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I heard enough.
This is just melt your heart.
Where's that barf bucket from hour one?
I feel like watching Moonlighting now.
I suppose you got seasons 1 through 12.
Oh, jeez.
There was only 5 seasons.
I'd rather listen to Susan Boyle.
Yeah, you'd rather kiss Susan Boyle.
Oh, man. Dude, I would make love to her just all fancy.
The blind way, right? No pun intended.
That's right.
Hey, I'm trying to hear this.
Should we sing along?
No. Come on now. Better. Oh.
We're like Buddy Holly the Crickets or ZZ Top, three-piece band here.
Okay, all right. That's
that's Bruce Willis.
Yeah, that's
that's Bruno there, baby.
Oh, man. That's about as bad as Tiny Tim.
Oh, this is better. This is better.
Oh, jeez. Where you coming from, man?
This is Bruce. Bruno, come on. Show your respect yourself.
Jeez, man.
Oh,
Bruce Willis.
Hold on. Here's Sean's other theme song.
Oh,
sorry.
Great. Oh, come on. Why? Why? What did I ever do to deserve? I can't even sing that high.
I've seen you running around before you go to work in the morning.
The secret is a vice grip.
Oh. I mean, I feel like, I don't know, I'm in some psychedelic world now or whatever. You know?
Come on, Sean, sing.
I don't even know the words. Yeah, I like Bruce because he's more manly. He has a more manlier voice, you know, a sick voice. You know?
If this guy, if was there ever a fight between Tiny Tim and a grizzly bear, you better get help. Better get some help with that grizzly bear.
Yeah. Jeez.
If I need somebody to back me, I'm going to fight. I'll look at Double T's, man.
Double T's.
The show has gone to a new low.
Okay, no. Here's a new low.
There you go.
Yeah. We're in the basement now.
I feel like I'm a King. I feel like I'm a King Ralph right now. John Goodman.
This is Sean in his bathtub singing.
Well, I'm pulling my rubber ducky, popping the bubbles as they come up.
He's got his butt. Like, all right, let's get out of this.
Oh boy.
Wait a minute.
Tiny bubbles.
Sing it, Sean.
Make me one more.
Singing like he's drunk. Get that guy off the stage. Get him a voiceover job.
Yeah.
Donnie Bubbles in the wine. I can't believe it. It's Don Ho.
All right,
it's 9 minutes.
Available on CD or cassette.
Did you say Don Howe?
No, I did not. Yeah. And he'll kick your butt for saying that. 9 minutes after 8. Why not go into our favorite segment here on the Tuesday Night Experiment? At least one guy's favorite segment on the Tuesday Night Experiment.
It's movie time!
Movie time!
Movie time!
Oh, boy.
With Sugar Sean.
Well, you know what that means, guys. I got to whip out my camera. So excuse me as I whip it out.
Oh,
the
man.
The camera, that is.
Jeez, come on.
Come on, Sean.
Mr. One-liner guy.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Hopefully you just erased everything on there.
Sean's movie time music going.
I can't erase magic, guys.
All right, Sean, tell us what's on the DVD review for this week.
Well, this week, we've been talking about Facebook a little bit in our little comedy here.
Oh, don't do that movie. Come on
The
now.
Social Network comes out today.
Now, do you have plans to watch this movie and give us a review here?
I actually was thinking about buying it or renting it this weekend. So I got the weekend off. So yeah, I was thinking about
just
doing
wait
that.
A week and go to a pawn shop, and you should be able to find a copy there.
Pawn shops don't have everything, especially the one in town here. Ugh.
Oh,
Trust me.
Yeah, kill the heat with the one pawn shop we were going to do some business with.
Yeah. I mean, I love the pawn shop. The pawn shop here is great. You know, the guy is just wonderful. You know? If he doesn't shoot you, but anyway.
Slauson, you're
you're offending all the potential advertisers.
Do you think that guy listened to
you're
our
nothing
show?
But a skinny little bitch. Now, come on, get back to your saying.
Okay, we're going to talk about a classic right now, a movie that came out 20 years ago, 1991.
Did you only get one new release here?
These are the things that I found.
Okay.
They were still on the releases here.
All right.
Dances with Wolves. This came out with the 20th anniversary edition on Blu-ray and DVD.
Was that about 9 hours, that movie? I remember watching that in school.
Is that a double disc?
Yes.
Tatanka.
As the DVD and the Blu-ray included, of course.
Buffalo. Tatanka.
I haven't seen that movie in years.
Are you talking Tatanka?
You make fire.
Tell us more about this movie, Sean.
Tatanka.
Well, if you remember, it's with Kevin Costner and his journey through the wilderness and all the adventures that he would have and encounters, you know, with Westerns. It's almost like a lost Western almost.
How come they never have Easterns?
Do a little teepee creeping in that movie.
I had the MGM edition of it. Like, well, obviously it's from MGM, but I mean, like,
what's
the
difference?
DVD of it.
Did that go bankrupt too? Or
yeah.
No, I don't know what I did with that copy. It was a nice, had a nice package too. It was like an old time, you know, felt package or whatever. Cover case.
Well, you don't watch the package, you watch the movie.
Yeah, who cares?
Gotta love the package. My whole thing on that is if they package it really nicely, you know it's gonna be good. You know? Anyway.
Okay, come on, Tatanka.
Piranha. Are you afraid of piranhas at all?
No.
Well, that comes out of Blu-ray and DVD today.
Okay.
Piranha, the movie.
Are you gonna watch this one too?
Probably not.
Okay.
No.
I mean, I was thinking about that too, but then it's like, nah, I'd rather watch Social Network.
Well, wasn't that one of those movies that was coming up with the big 3D boom last fall?
Yeah,
it was one of those. One
is
of the
Social Network in 3D?
No.
See, they suck.
They can't put everything in 3D. You know?
Yeah, they can.
They shouldn't. I mean, if they're gonna do it, make sure it's a purpose.
Next up, Woody Allen's movies.
like the Tron movies would be perfect in 3D. You know,
but not
everything. You know. Yeah. Okay, and the last one that I got for the week is something that, you know, since we're talking about science and whatnot, you know, since our guest was a doctor.
Dr. Rutledge, and we thank him once again for coming on.
The Universe, the Seven Wonders of the Solar System, comes out on Blu-ray 3D.
Now, that'd be trippy.
Oh, these are all today out on Blu-ray.
Yeah, today.
January
11th,
right on.
2011.
He walked out to Walmart and had his pen out and was writing them down.
Yep.
Said, my pen is my...
Hey, do you mind if I pop this in the Blu-ray player quick and just give her a test run?
And then the cops came and they arrested me.
All right, but enough about your social life. Let's get back into it.
And now it's time for the picks of the week.
Picks of the week.
The first
Sugar
picks of the week.
Sean's pick of the week.
Are you making fun of my nasal problem? There?
No, he's
no. I was just clearing my throat.
Uh-huh. Okay.
No, I just had some mucus up there.
Oh, you mean some eggnog?
Man, dude, there is a wicked cough going around, man.
All right, Sean.
All right.
I'm not going to the dentist.
So this pick of the week, the current pick of the week, is something that I actually picked up here the week of Christmas. It came out, and I was so happy.
3-2 flu?
No. Family Guy. It's a Trap.
Ooh. Oh, yeah.
And I finally got the last. This is the last one, and I actually have all three of them on DVD now.
Family Guy. Are they still showing that thing?
Yeah. They just had the new episode
that
on.
A long time.
They had the new episode out on Sunday. Coming back with animation domination there.
Did you watch Bob's Burgers then, too?
Yes, I did. That
was lame. Come on now. That
was
show just
funny.
Lame. Do you find that funny?
His wife had a manly voice. I was laughing.
Because the guy's doing practically all the voices.
Wow, but
he's a low rent Seth MacFarlane.
Okay. Do you remember the first burger that they had that was for sale or whatever that they were going to promote when the health inspectors came in?
I think I was watching some backlog Boardwalk Empire episodes on my DVR, so I didn't know how to have an
answer. It was a child molester with candy.
Oh,
you know?
Forget that.
Oh, gosh. Because,
you know, they use candy sometimes. Anyway.
Enough of that. That's too sticky.
Burgers.
Too sticky,
yeah,
Sean.
Too sticky. Okay. So here's my little review on that DVD. It's Seth MacFarlane's take on the original Star Wars trilogy.
Because that's what the world needs is more Seth MacFarlane.
Heck yeah.
Wonderful visions.
That guy is a genius.
Talk about another puker when he talks.
That guy is a genius. I mean, I love Family Guy. And that's not panda. That's just love.
It jumped the shark 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah, but if...
You notice how they use filler on that show?
That's exactly why a lot of people like it, because that's why I like it, because of the illusion.
I'm still watching The Simpsons, but I've tuned out the Family Guy stuff. But I'm glad that you enjoy it, though. That's your thing.
Yeah, and It's a Trap isn't as overly funny as, you know, the other two. Blue Harvest and something Dark Side.
Something Dark Side.
But it still manages to deliver the goods and ends things on a high enough note.
Hey, man.
But I do recommend it because it's something that, you know, if you now watch, if any of you listeners out there have the complete series of that set, a Blu-ray or a DVD. I do recommend watch it a few times and really paying attention to all the funny, you know, other than just the story of Star Wars, but the funny illusions that they have. They use a Pee-wee reference in this one. I thought it would be
Well, there you go.
Oh, God, dude. You guys want to wheel me by Walmart?
So in the second one, in the second one, they
Hey, hold on. We have a Pee-wee one, too. Does that make us funny?
Fine.
But, I mean...
Hold on. We got one more.
Well, are you uptight or what?
I'm taking a wild guess here that you actually used that site that I showed you, didn't you?
This is stuff I had earlier. I had this stuff earlier, dude.
Okay, I wasn't
sure. Please save your questions until I'm through!
So anyway, Family Guy, It's
Paul
a Trap
Rubens,
is
man.
My... Family Guy, It's a Trap is my current pick of the week. Of course, you know, without the current...
I don't know about that one. This one for me, that last one for me is just...
Come on, yeah. For once I want to hear a fart sound effect. And if you have to do it for real, go ahead.
All you get is this.
The classic pick of the week.
Classic!
Now, you know, and this, pick of the week. I love doing this part because I can pick pretty much anything retro.
Yeah, just like how he didn't pick A Christmas Story.
Yeah.
Are you still on that? That was like 3 weeks ago. Come on.
I know, man.
It may be a classic in your
You know,
heart.
When I watched it like five times in a row on TBS, yeah. I thought of you, buddy.
Oh, you did?
And yeah, I was wondering if Frankie Five Sassy Pants is watching this.
I watched it a little bit. Sounds like somebody has asthma over here.
Sounds like a
great man. I watched it a little bit on Christmas, but see, that's what I mean. They overplay it too much, and it's like...
Well, it's only once a year.
Yeah,
it's only once a year, dude.
I'd like to see 24 hours of Jingle All the Way.
What are you talking about, fool?
Which I did watch with my family.
I bet you watched that Jerry Lewis telethon, too.
We watched Jingle All the Way while we're opening Christmas presents or whatever at my family's place. Anyway.
Oh, my goodness.
So the classic...
Did your parents give you gas money to go home?
I got money.
Oh,
okay. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I do.
But they're
dig
just
it.
Saying, get the hell out of our house. What are you coming back here for?
Hey, I was good to my nephews and nieces this year. I was very good to them. Anyway, the classic pick of the week is none other than the Police Academy box set.
When did you discover that you were so beautiful?
Whoa,
are you trying to say I'm beautiful? Anyway.
Police Academy is all right.
And I actually own the whole box set, and I've seen every one of them.
You got that right, crazy man.
And for any 80s
fan... You know, the first Police Academy probably came out before you were even born, dude.
Actually, it came out the year after I was born.
Aye, aye!
I was born...
Admiral Butthead.
I was born... I was born in 1983, so it came out in 84. Actually, the production was in 83. It was released
See?
In 84,
now,
but...
The
know.
Screenplay, I bet, was written before you were even...
Yes.
Born.
So let's talk a little bit about the Police Academy box set, shall we?
Oh, well, hey, you know.
Try to stop me from hitting you.
What are we going to talk about, Jonesy?
This is a great box set. The Police Academy series is my favorite comic series. Along
I'll
with
break
the,
you in half like a little toothpick.
Along with the Naked Gun series. I'm going to keep talking. National Lampoon's Vacation series, Austin Powers series, and the Scary Movie series.
Oh, behave.
I'm so glad that the series is finally out on DVD. And the only problem I have is that you see, the first one, second, third, sixth, and the seventh are in widescreen, which is perfect.
Yeah. I would have come at you like a tornado made of arms and teeth and fingernails.
But number four and number five, for some reason, they had to put in full screen, which would be fine if it was full screen.
Budget cuts.
If it was full screen and 16:9, you know, widescreen.
Yeah. Uh-uh, brother.
But, no, they had to go full screen 4:3, so no. I don't know why they would do that.
Yeah, you better write them. Yeah.
As far as features,
get your pad and
okay,
paper.
Do they
out.
Have any good outtakes in there?
Yeah, they got pad, especially the first one is the 20th anniversary edition of the set.
Oh yeah,
and then the rest are just trailers and documentaries. It comes like in a 7-part documentary.
Woo,
each disc has like 5 minutes or whatever.
There
so go. Yeah, so there you go, everybody, ladies and gentlemen, ladies and germs, you know. Trigger Sean's.
I didn't know we could fit that many people in here.
I know, we got a crammed audience here.
Woohoo! You guys break bed bugs?
We're is Ted Williams. Huh? Magic 98.9.
When you want the golden oldies.
Well, there you go.
Well, thank you so much, Sugar Sean. We're going to do some music news, but we're going to play some tunes here before we
All right. Do I get to make a request?
No, just kidding. Yeah, do you have anything in mind here?
Long-time listener, first-time caller.
How about I got some old school social distortion for you.
Social D in the house.
Yeah, we're trying to work on getting Mike Ness to come and do a little interview for us here on the Tuesday Night Experiment. Maybe even the month of February.
We should get Ted Williams on here.
Oh man, I wish I totally
you get
wish.
Our station wrong. You think we're Magic 98.9?
I'll send him a script.
See, we're very professional around here. Let's get into some social D. No, we're not lulling you to sleep. We're just working on the last frame of the Tuesday Night Experiment on Pioneer 90.1 FM KSRQ. I know. I'm just. You guys totally beat me to the punch on the La Bamba reference.
Yeah, well, because of before we used to use that reference. I think
we used in the past too.
Yeah.
My little tamale.
Well, next week on the show we're gonna have another guest. Yes, we're still booking.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna have an author with this is very well timed. We got an author by the name of Richard Rushfield. He's got a book called American Idol: The Untold Stories. We're gonna learn some behind the scenes scuttlebutt about the world's most popular karaoke show.
Yeah.
That's been going on for about, 10 years?
10 years, yeah. Buddy. Ten years. Seasons.
Days.
And it took, I don't know how many for Simon Cowell to finally.
Speaking of a new reality show or whatever, Tough Enough comes back, after WrestleMania. Anybody care about that?
I don't think anyone cares about that under the age of.
I just wanted to ask you.
I lift stuff up and put it down.
Maybe Al Snow will make a return. I don't know.
Richard Rushfield next week on the show in the 7 o'clock hour is going to talk about American Idol, the untold story. Next Wednesday, American Idol launches its new season with some new judges, except Randy Jackson's the only holdout from the original show. Yeah. We're going
to
have some.
Randy's got nowhere to go.
We got Steven Tyler and J-Lo entering into the mix. That should be quite interesting. But, next week, guys, we'll talk about some American Idol. You guys, this is one you can even throw in some banter, maybe.
All right. There
you guys are always you're too nice to me come interview time. It's like I look over and Blind Dog, he's just being nice.
I know, man. I don't want to step on your toes.
Same with me.
No. I appreciate it. But, next week, if you guys want to throw a question in or something, I'll let you guys have a question.
Can I ask him about carjacking?
No, something that pertains to American Idol, not former Idol stars who basically have to resort to carjacking.
Can I ask him if it's actually rigged?
Yeah, if you want to.
I know for a fact it's rigged.
You know what?
I do, man.
Save that question for next week.
It's the record labels that put them up to it. I'm serious, dude. That's all it is.
Voting, I thought.
No.
You are so naive.
That's how they get their demographic, man.
Oh.
Yeah.
You're naive.
I know it.
Well, we got some music news here. I got a few musical news items for you, friends. It seems like Billy Green Day, is this headline says, another Green Day musical.
Billy Joe, whatever his name is.
Billy Joe Armstrong, Green Day frontman, feels inspired to write his own musical after enjoying the success of the band's American Idiot show on Broadway. Wrong thing to do. The singer is currently performing as a regular cast member in the hit production, which is based on the rocker's popular 2004 album of the same name. Armstrong admits he now feels ready to indulge his newfound passion for musical theater by writing his own show. He tells the New York Times, I think I'd be interested in the future of really getting into writing specifically for a show. I'm sounding like Pee-wee here. That's something I'd really love to do. The kind of music that I like is very immediate and very catchy, and you identify with it quickly. And I try to write that way. And in musical theater, it's the same thing. You identify with the songs immediately, the good ones anyway. I'm so glad. It sucks that Kurt Cobain's not around, but do you think he would have went that route eventually, too?
Oh, God, no.
I think so. I have a bad feeling that, did you ever think, back when we were younger, let's go back to, 1995.
Oh, yeah, I remember those days.
Four score and many pounds ago.
Yeah, the Toadies. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But if somebody said that, came up to you I'm from the future, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And they said, what's going to happen in the future music-wise? Green Day is going to be making a musical that's going to be a popular hit on Broadway. Yeah. What would you? What would we have said to that?
It's got to be stopped.
he'll be like, no. You'd be like, you kidding me? We would have been punks about that. They would never do that. That's the last resort. This and that and the other.
Oh, man. But, I heard a story about rock and roll going away, man. Serious, dude.
Isn't it kind of starting to already with all this Justin Bieber fever and all these songs that sound like a boot in a dryer?
Yeah, and all the hip-hop and Top 40.
And the video game soundtrack noises that they make.
Oh, with the voice boxes?
Yeah.
Auto-tune.
We got to find an auto-tune.
Yeah, I think there's a plug-in for that for Adobe Audition.
Should we look for that? I think we should.
Auto-tune the show.
But, you know what? When you say that, though, you're not joking. It's almost like it could be a sign of things to come here in the not-too-distant future. It scares me, man.
Mm-hmm.
Where's our rock and roll going?
It's going away.
Rock and roll heaven, I guess.
Yeah. I guess if you believe in heaven, then life is just a one-night stand.
there was one new band that I had a chance to catch on David Letterman the other night. What is it? The Black Keys?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're pretty cool.
Nice little two-piece when they got their little auxiliary members. But, I mean, the main two, the core two, they've been putting out some great records in the last 10 years. And yeah, that gives me hope.
And that's her first time on Letterman, right? I'm pretty sure it's got to be, dude.
Yeah, they did SNL over the weekend, too.
Oh, so they're making the New York show loop there.
And then
they
did that Diamond. Why not? Diamond commercial or whatever? They did the music for it or whatever?
Diamond Dave?
I don't know. No.
Oh, a jewelry commercial?
Jewelry, yeah. It's like Diamond Store or something like that.
Well, it's cross-marketing. Like that's just kind of the way of the world on that. Yeah. But, I dig the Black Keys. I like the album Brothers they put out last year. I think that there's one right there.
I tell you one thing about Dave Letterman. So cool. He doesn't hold up a CD, right? He actually holds up a 33 and a third album, man.
Yeah, they've been doing that for a while. That's though. Jimmy Fallon.
I dig it, man. Yeah.
Dave and Jimmy, that's, you know, they actually respect the origins of the music.
I know, man. Vinyl is where it's at, buddy.
You know, and vinyl is selling pretty decent as a niche sort of thing. I mean,
check out Best Buy. They got a section right there with newly released vinyl.
I mean, they're not selling in the millions or hundreds of thousands, but some of these sales are getting 30,000, and that's pretty good for a medium that was basically discarded.
Yep.
Way back in, what, late 80s? They kind of phased it out?
I don't know. Well, CDs came along, cassettes.
Mid to late 80s, things started getting phased out as far as what was the main thing.
I think the cassettes totally stomped it out once cassettes came along.
Yeah.
Matrix.
You know, it is really cool that another new generation of listeners is getting a chance to check out vinyl.
Yeah.
Some of us old dogs can sit and listen to it and tell them how wonderful this stuff was.
I got to get a new stylist for my turntable, man.
You still looking for that?
Yeah. I wonder what they did with the old ones out here, man. I could probably use one of them.
Well, maybe they got some.
I'll have to sweet talk Mr. Mark Johnson about that, man, because, you know, it's been about a year since my turntable's been out of commission, and I have some badass albums. I have Lamb of God on vinyl.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I have Rage Against the Machine, Evil Empire on vinyl.
Oh, that'd be cool to hear.
Also, some old school stuff from Guns N' Roses and Appetite. I have that on vinyl.
I got Appetite. That's a vintage.
And then I have that double disc color album from that Mike Watt guy on vinyl, too.
Oh, that's pretty cool. Is that the Ball Hogger Tugboat album?
Yep. Okay. Yeah, with the wrestling.
With the wrestling gimmick on
Yep.
Okay, I remember
that. Henry Rollins is on there too, man.
Yeah, like Eddie Vedder's on there, Evan Dando from it was like basically an all-star, alt-rock, all-star album when it came out.
It's like a bunch of guest stars on there. It was pretty cool, man.
Speaking of alt-rock all-stars from the 90s, Courtney Love's Twitter account has been taken offline as the rocker prepares to go to court to fight allegations she defamed a fashion designer on the microblogging website. She finds new mediums to get herself in trouble in.
No kidding. Twitter.
She's getting all sassy on there, huh?
Yeah, here's more about it. The whole star has been sued by Don Simon Ranker, who alleges Love damaged her reputation with a series of angry tweets in March 2009. Attorneys for both sides are due to appear at a mandatory settlement conference in Los Angeles later this week and will go to trial next month on the 11th if an agreement is not reached. Love's account is on the site, has now been removed as her lawyers prepare to go into action.
Now, can she open up a new account now?
Yeah, she goes under a different one.
So she could go under an alias now.
Yeah, like I'm an alcoholic.
Like on Facebook, you said
you can't change the username after it's done, but you can make a new profile. Sure.
Oh, a username. Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought you were talking.
But you can still use, you can still make up a new profile if you want.
Well, yeah,
just
I got
change the name.
I have Blind Dog Facebook thing.
Yeah. We're friends on there. We all have Facebook.
Yeah, we're all brothers on the Facebook. Yeah, look at us. Yeah.
I, you know, being I'm not at that other crap shack north of town, that one station there
by the ball bearing warehouse.
Yeah. I don't check Facebook too much, man. I used to all the time at work.
I like Facebook. Know? I mean, I know, you know, it's like, oh, you're a geek if you're on a computer and all that stuff. But you know what? I mean,
back in the 80s, yeah.
It's a future. I mean, yeah, we can joke.
Back in the 80s, yeah.
We can joke around all we want about, you know, MySpace, Facebook, Twitter, whatever, but it's the future. Our future, anyway. So.
Well, yeah. I don't know. I dig Facebook. Well, all right.
You can find out more about us. Hey, you can even go on there and friend our, you know, and put a friend request into us. I mean,
oh, yeah.
I mean, my name's Glenn Broggett.
And just look for Blind Dog Scott Gilbert. It's right there, man.
And for me, I have to use Frankie Slauson Show because that's my alter ego.
That's your
There's
Facebook,
a couple other Blind Facebook Dogs handle? On there, too. Yeah. But they're not as cool as I am.
And not as blind.
Yeah. Yeah, just...
anyway.
And you can tell mine is... It's a drawn picture.
It's a nice little caricature.
Yeah. I got that done when I worked for the oldies station, yeah, man. Yeah. That's the old Barney Miller photo.
Oh, I forgot about that old handle.
Yeah, I miss those days, dude.
I miss oldies on FM radio.
Yeah, KSNR. Jim Zippo in the morning.
I was on there, man. I was on that signal.
Barney Miller.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Thanks for calling. Thanks for listening, Reynolds.
Gotta love Zippo in the morning.
I had this crazy lady call in all the time from Warren, and she called me Beetle Barty or something like that. And I said, no, it's Barney Miller. Woman, get it right. Yeah.
So if you
work for Motown.
If you work for the station at KSNR, what was up with the quality of the... Like I know like they had this Del Shan song, The Runaway... But it seemed like they were using not the original version. It was like an alternate version or something.
Are
like
you talking about after it moved to Grand Forks or before?
I guess.
What year?
Probably
what
before.
Year? Yeah, what year
I'm
are we talking
probably
about?
Probably 95 through.
Oh, you know, that was through the satellite music network and whatever copy they used. That's the one that was placed.
Oh, so you never...
So, yeah, that time
never...
that you brought that pumpkin pie over to your favorite, to Jim Zippel.
Yeah.
Nobody was there.
Oh,
did
wow.
you guys ever meet the two-hip Zip dude?
No, I did not get a chance.
Well, he did that Prime Steel car show over there a few times.
Oh, yeah, we have. I have our friends on Facebook.
He's still
Zippel.
Alive?
Yeah, he just had a birthday.
Right on, man.
Yeah, for anybody that follows birthdays on Facebook.
Jim Zippo.
Sean did a very breathless version of Happy Birthday.
I wish him a happy birthday. I said, yeah, he's the legendary Jim Zippo.
Is he still syndicated?
Yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. He's still doing his thing.
Wow.
I've been trying to actually do like a private interview with him on YouTube and whatnot, but he...
Why are you in the YouTube stuff? You should be booking him on our stuff.
Book it on here, dude. He's a brother and of the biz.
If that means I get permission, I will try the best I can to get the Zippo.
Well, if you want to come and do an interview, you bring him on, you put him on the show, you line up this thing, and we'll run with it. All three of us will run with it.
Okay.
Is he still shacking up with that Marie as his sidekick?
I don't know.
She probably moved on in the radio biz. But he used to
I'll
do
what
it from.
I can, and I'll let you guys know.
Yeah, he was in Dallas, Texas.
Yeah,
for a long time.
Yeah, that's where
I would have liked to
right
known Jim Zippo, but mm-hmm. I was just a kid.
I tell a joke.
Legend never did.
I got in on his morning show once, man.
I think I got in on a Ron Foster instant request.
Did you?
I think I played some I Got You, I Feel Good, James
Well,
Brown.
Your request is bound to come up in a rotation.
No,
of
they
like
play 300. They play my audio, my little...
Oh, really?
Yeah, they played my phone call.
Oh, right on.
I'm big time, dog.
I almost got on their morning show. They had Crappy Joke Monday or whatever it was.
Oh, Crappy Joke Monday.
Yeah, hey, Jim, you know why chickens don't wear underwear? And you can...
fill in the blank.
Yeah, fill in the punchline, and he kind of told me, oh, that's too raunchy for oldies radio, but that's funny stuff.
Woo, that's racy chat. I got some more news here about the group Kiss, and Kiss trying to sell something else.
Oh, great.
Come on, that's a group that never sells anything.
Yeah, they can have my second farewell t-shirt back.
We survived the flood in 97, Kiss. You can get a hot nickel for it.
I hate those guys. They do one farewell tour, and then two more years after that, it's another farewell tour.
I did see him at the Minnesota State Fair last summer.
Oh, right on.
Really good, though. That's the thing. That's the thing. They get
you. Dude, when I seen Kiss at the Alaris Center with Aerosmith,
I totally think Kiss stole the show. Aerosmith just kind of, you know?
Yeah.
And Aerosmith went on first. What's up with that?
I think it was like when they did the coin flip sort of thing.
Oh. Well, what? Don't you think they got to do like stage adjustments for that? Probably not.
Oh, they probably had everything plotted out when they decided on the tour.
Well, I've been going on YouTube a lot, obviously, because I do YouTube, obviously.
You do YouTube? Yeah, YouTube.
Anyway, why do you YouTube?
You know, there's programs for that if you need help, man.
Yeah. But anyway, the point that I was trying to make,
we're
anyway.
Not the support group.
Well, we're talking about Kiss or whatever. You go on YouTube, you can find just about any Kiss demo that they've done from all their albums out there.
For the hardcore Kiss, man.
I love Lick It Up, Take Five. Just bass and guitar.
Or like Unholy or whatnot, or Hooligan.
The outtakes, the Beth.
Beth string section.
But I'm serious. I mean, you can find all that stuff, and it's just amazing. But you listen to it, and it's just...
I got
to
shout it out loud, backing vocals.
It blows me away. You know, I'll tell you. What a night.
One of the coolest Kiss songs got to be God of Thunder.
Oh, absolutely.
Or Firehouse. That's another good one.
Cold Gin.
Yeah, Cold Gin.
Domino. Yeah.
Christine. 16.
Oh, that Love Gun album's underrated, man. Plaster Caster.
Know it, dude.
Oh, man. Did people talk about how great Destroyer was?
Oh, yeah. Man.
But, I mean, Love Gun, I think, is it's less conceptual.
Yep.
I think it's right up there. It gives them a hot run for their money. And even that little cover, that old Phil Spector tune, And She Kissed Me.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was like that was a cool reworking. Not to say Destroyer's a bad album, but I think Love Gun's a dark horse.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Hotter Than Hell was pretty good. I like Dressed to Kill. Self-titled of the Alive album.
That double platinum one, was that a best of?
Kind of a best of. I think they may have did like a re-record on one.
Oh, okay. I used to have that when I was a youngster.
They redid Strutter on that one.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think they're... I remember that, too. There was like a Strutter 78.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
And, you know, I remember getting I love the Kiss Dynasty album because I got the big poster.
Oh, cool.
Oh, man, that poster was badass. Well, we got some Kiss news. Kiss has never been shy of investigating and seizing marketing opportunities. From condoms to coffins, and soon fans will be able to adorn their gardens with little gnome versions of the Star Child, the Demon, the Spaceman, and the Catman. Kiss offered a sneak peek of the gnome designs on their official website this week. The picture, as presented on the site, presents an artist's rendition of the four band members standing guard over a suburban garden in the dark. A little tweaking via image editing software reveals a little more detail, but not enough to determine whether the Catman and Spaceman figures are based on Peter, Chris, and Ace Frehley, or if they're based on Eric Singer and Tommy Thayer, their replacements. The gnomes are being released by licensee Gorilla Cover. Gorilla Cover sources and manufactures licensed products for properties including the U.S. Army, Canadian Football League, and Tattoo Johnny. Kiss will head back into this recording studio for a new album due in mid-2011, following from the success of their 2009 Sonic Boom, their first release since Psycho Circus in 1998.
They're going on tour again!
The Walmart album.
Yeah, they sold a lot of money. Them, AC/DC, all that. That's a smart way to get your album sold in this day and age.
Yeah.
I kind of like some of the tracks in Sonic Boom.
How they got that black ice out there, AC/DC.
Yeah.
And they sold like 800,000 copies. Like,
through Walmart?
Yeah. There was a Walmart.
Oh, come on.
Walmart available to it. Or
you know, think about it. How many people go to Walmart these days, man?
Well, that's one of the... Yeah,
all of us do.
Everybody consumes.
I just go there to loiter, man. I don't know what you guys do.
I mean, they're busy all the time, it seems like, besides at night. But,
that's usually when I try to go is when it's not so busy.
Yeah, when all the crackheads are rolling through there at night.
Or all the crackheads that are working there.
No, the one at Grand Forks is worse.
Oh, I suppose,
You know what? It's the most peaceful for me at that time.
You can get your shopping done and get out of there really quickly.
In and out. Yeah. You don't have to worry about...
You don't have to worry about screaming kids and...
None of that.
Mommy, get me this! I see little Jimmy at school. He had one of these. I want it.
But it's a Justin Bieber Trapper Keeper.
And, you know, they got a... Walmart and Kmart, too, has updated their poster section. I'm sick and tired of looking at...
They still have Miley
up
there?
You're pushing freaking 30. You can't buy posters.
I'm sick of looking at shirtless... I'm sick and tired of looking at shirtless guys as the first poster I see when I...
When you already have my home on the wall.
Yeah, that's right. You know?
Yeah, you walk by. Ooh, I got to buy that.
Yeah, I got to start frapping.
Ooh, is that a two-for-one?
Twilight.
I'm just sick of seeing that. I mean, I want like a... Buddy Holly poster. I'll be happy.
Just you know be what? Honest. You got a Justin Bieber poster at home.
I don't have Bieber fever, bro. The movie.
No, just a Bieber cold.
The movie looks pretty good, though, that they're coming out with here. The 3D movie next month or whatever.
Oh, no. Are we back to a movie review guy?
Never say never.
I don't know.
What are you talking about? That's scary when I hear you talking about
it. Well, has, New Kids on the Block
memorabilia. I don't know. I saw the trailer. The trailer looks pretty good, but yeah, I'm not a Bieber fan, though.
We got to get you to better movies.
Well, yeah. That's the test.
What are you doing with that Netflix account, man?
What's the last movie you've watched on Netflix?
Don't you just go to Hulu for that? Come on now.
Well, you can, but most of those are just clips and stuff.
I like Hulu, man.
You want the full meal deal, you go to Netflix.
Well, if you pay a subscription thing, do you get it on
If you have a little money, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, not like old golden voice DJ Panhandle.
Yeah. should I do a movie intro for you in the golden voice?
That would be
Should I look for some music
that would warm my heart.
20th Century Fox theme.
Hey, I did pretty good for Christmas this year, you know, as far as DVDs and stuff. I got Harry and the Hendersons. I got the Polar Express. I got the Three Stooges first three volumes of the 8-volume set that they finally released. And
why don't you get a good movie like Pineapple Express?
I was thinking about buying that. It was $9 at Walmart.
Oh, it's in the $9 section? Right on.
Looks like a good one. I remember when they talked about Comic-Con in 2009.
That's Seth Rogen's in there, right?
Yep.
Should we get back to that mid-60s brassy music again?
Okay.
Here we go.
Let's do some more Ted Williams commercials.
Well, I want to thank everybody for joining us on this edition of the Tuesday Night Experiment. Come back again next week for 2 great hours from 7 to 9 p.m. on Pioneer 90.1 FM, RadioNorthland.org. I'm your host, Glenn Brock, and along with the blind dog, Scott Gilbert, and Sugar Sean Lawson. Thanks again for listening to the show. We'll be back in 7 days with another great edition. Pioneer 90.1 Tuesday Night Experiment. That's the way you do it.
That's a keeper, man.
You should record that. Well, I guess you are recording.
It's already recorded.
Yeah, I guess.
That's a one and done. You got it recording at home anyway.
Yeah,
that's true.
Well, gang, we've made it through another edition. Back live doing our thing once again on the show. I do want to thank our guest, Dr. Rutledge.
Oh, yeah. The DDT.
Teaching us about DDT.
Next time, you got to get Dr. M&L Brown. I'm sure he's still around.
We should get Ted Williams on the show. The real Ted Williams, man. Yeah.
His head is sitting cryogenically in Arizona or something.
Dude, just give it 2 weeks and we can call him at the Betty Ford Clinic.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, looking for my buddy Ted. I'm his sponsor.
Scotty, I love you, Scotty.
And for any of you guys who actually do care about Ted Williams, part two of the Dr. Phil special will be on tomorrow.
Oh, Sugar Sean.
You watched Dr. Phil?
I only watched it because of the Ted Williams thing.
I love you, Shawnee.
He probably watches the Oprah Winfrey Network, too.
Nate Berkus.
Yes, but the thing about it, you got to realize, it is a feel-good story, though. I mean, how many feel-good stories do you hear in the media now?
I'm just speaking from someone who's like... Who's a radio on-air personality.
Oh, I understand.
And knows radio on-air personalities and some that need jobs that probably do just as good a job as he does.
Oh, of course. But I'm just saying it's just a feel-good
There's
story.
There's a lot of DJs that are barely above the poverty line and they're still working. Yeah, they need a little more respect in their moment in the sun.
You know, DJs, come on. You know where you can tell where we live. DJ U-Haul in the backyard.
Exactly. They just buy it outright.
But no, I understand what you're saying, and you know, all three of us could be. You know, we should be.
That guy jumped the shark last week with all that stuff.
We should be.
He took my job. I was gonna do that in Grand Forks on 32nd. Hey,
what?
Bring me back to KJ.
Kraft macaroni and cheese.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Y Dog.
You'd be the sponsor for Trojan condoms, so I'm sure.
Enough of that.
Think you're man enough to try the new Trojan condom. Endorsed by many celebrities.
And Sugar Sean's Lawson.
Molded by John Holmes.
Apple cinnamon flavor.
Hey now, you guys.
Cinnamon flavor. Come on.
No more raciness. We got to get on out of here, guys.
Do we got a couple more minutes? No.
Actually, we got a couple more seconds to go. We're gonna wrap up the show with a group that Blind Dog and I were talking about here a few minutes back, the Black Keys.
Oh, yeah.
We got the second single from their album from their album Brothers. It's called Tighten Up. It's time for us to bust on out of here. Next week, mud wrestling. Oh, no.
In the studio.
Yeah. Hey, actually, we're going to be talking American Idol with Richard Rushfield, his new book. And I should be getting in here this week in the mail. I'll do a quick little read on it, and I'll be ready. And you guys can have questions, too, next week.
Can we have tryouts in the studio here, too?
I think so. And Sugar Sean, get a song ready for next week.
All right.
Write the name of a song you want to sing, because I can get the karaoke version. Yeah. You want to Facebook me on that?
Okay.
You're going to sing a song for us.
Right after the interview, we'll have...
Oh, great. Yeah, I do know some songs, so...
Blind Dog, you too, man.
Yeah.
Come up with
we
a song.
We should do like an American Idol show.
We're not going to sing together.
I'll do a song, man.
Okay, we'll get Blind Dog with a song. Just Facebook me the name of a song. We'll find a karaoke version.
Okay.
I want it by the weekend from you so I can get everything going.
I'll have it to you by...
Oh, yeah, dude, I'll have it tomorrow, man.
All right. You want me to find the karaoke version?
Okay,
just write me a name of a song, and we'll do some American Idol karaoke.
Next week, what hour is that guy calling in?
He's going to be calling us at 7:30 next
week. Okay, so right around 8-ish, you can hear Crash Course Karaoke on the radio.
Course Karaoke on the radio.
That should be fun.
I think I might have to do a Debbie Gibson song. That's coming up 7 days from now. This is the